Okay, thank you for the introduction, and thank you all for attending my talk, and thank you, Nolcon, for letting me speak here. So I'm going to talk about my research on WPA2, on specifically how we managed to break this well-known protocol. So this research actually has some interesting history, because during my PhD, I was already studying the security of Wi-Fi networks, and about 1.5 years ago, during my PhD defense, one of my jury members asked me, "Hey, Matti, you're recommending that we should all use WPA2 with AES. That's what I recommend in my thesis." And he asked, "Are you really sure that that's a secure solution on a secure protocol?" And about 1.5 years ago, my answer was, "Yeah, this seems like a secure solution. I mean, it's been around for more than a decade. There are formal proofs that state that it's secure. So it really seemed that this was a good solution." Unfortunately, around 1.5 years later, I was looking at some OpenBSD code, and you don't need to understand the details here, but I was staring at this function icsetkey, and what this function does, it installs a negotiated session key for use by encryption. So it installs the key to the driver so that data frames are encrypted. And I was just auditing this code for another purpose, but I was wondering, when I saw this function, what will happen if it's called twice? And answering that function led to the research that I'm going to present here today. In other words, this is how I discovered that WPA2 was weak. And to put it in a different way, this presentation is all about how I gave the wrong answer during my PhD defense. So, how is my talk structured? I'm first going to explain how this key reinstallation attack works against the four-way handshake. Then I'm going to discuss in a bit more detail what the practical impact of the attack is. After that, I'm going to cover a few misconceptions that have been floating around on the internet. And finally, I'm going to discuss some lessons that we can learn about this research and about our discoveries. So let's start with explaining how this attack works against the four-way handshake, because that really illustrates the main idea about how we can attack WPA2. So the first thing that I need to explain here is, what is the four-way handshake? And the four-way handshake is used whenever you connect to a protected Wi-Fi network. And it has two main purposes. The first purpose is that it provides mutual authentication, meaning you verify that the access point really is the access point that you want to connect to. And on the other hand, the access point also verifies that you possess the proper credentials. And at the same time, this four-way handshake also negotiates a fresh session key. And this session key is called the PTK. And this key will be used to encrypt data frames once the four-way handshake has completed. So, as I mentioned previously, about 1 year ago, I would say that this looked very secure, because there have been no attacks for more than a decade against these protocols. That's at least if you pick a secure password, because if you pick a weak password, then yeah, you can do dictionary attacks. But let's say that if you use enterprise authentication or if you use a strong password, then there really aren't known attacks. On top of that, there are formal proofs of both the four-way handshake and also the encryption protocol that is used after the four-way handshake. So it seemed that all of this was pretty good. But of course, we did manage to break it. And in order to explain how we managed to break it, I'm going to explain how the four-way handshake works in a bit more detail. So let's say that we have the client on the left for you guys, and the access point on the right. Then if the client wants to connect to the access point, the first thing that happens is, if you use an enterprise network, there's an optional 802.1x authentication stage. Now, we don't need to know the details about this. Basically, if you use an enterprise network where you have to log in, for example, using a username and password, you first have this authentication stage, and the result is that there is some shared secret between the client and the access point. And if you have a home network, this shared secret is simply the password of the network. So from now on, we'll simply assume that there is some shared secret between the client and the access point. And at that point, we can start executing the four-way handshake. And the four-way handshake is initiated by the access point. And the first two messages, they are used to transport random numbers between both devices. So in particular, the access point first generates a random number. The access point nonce, the A nonce, on it sends that to the client. On a return, the client generates its own random number, the supplicant nonce, and supplicant is basically a synonym for client, and it sends that to the access point. And once both these devices have this, these random numbers, these two random numbers are combined with a shared secret between both devices. And the result of this combination is the session key that the four-way handshake negotiated, and this PTK will be used to decrypt frames afterwards. Now, there's one thing I want to clarify here. As the title of the presentation said, the tech will involve nonce reuse. However, we don't assume, we're not going to reuse values for the A nonce or the S nonce. So we're going to assume that the A nonce and S nonce are generated properly here. The nonce reuse we are referring to will be the nonce reused during the encryption protocol. So here we assume the A nonce and S nonce, they are perfectly random, they are not predictable, and so on. So that covers the first stage of the four-way handshake. The second stage of the handshake, a bit simplified, is just used to confirm that both parties derive the same session key, the same PTK. And once they confirm this, the PTK is installed for usage, meaning at this point, we can exchange encrypted data frames between both devices. And that leads me to the last part that I need to introduce in order to understand attack, and that is, how are these data frames encrypted in a Wi-Fi network? So to explain this, let's say we want to send some plain text data to the other station. The first step that happens is that we take this negotiated session key, we take the PTK, and we combine it with a packet number. And this packet number is also called a nonce. And the idea is that this packet number will increase by one for every packet that is transmitted. And by combining the session key and the packet number, we are deriving a unique key for every packet that we want to send. And with this unique key, we will derive some key stream. Using a stream cipher, we will XOR that with the plain text data, and the result is the encrypted data. So basically, no matter how you configure your Wi-Fi network, it will always use some form of a stream cipher where you're XORing your plain text with keystream to get the encrypted packet. And then to send the packet, we add a plain text header to this as well, which include the nonce that was used to encrypt the packet. And this nonce is also used as a replay counter. So what's essential about this encryption scheme is that a particular packet number should never be reused under a specific session key. Because if we ever reuse a packet number, that means we are generating the same packet key, which in turn means we are generating the same key stream. And in general, if there is key stream reuse, your encryption protocol is broken, because there are always tricks to then decrypt data and sometimes even forge data. So the security of WPA2 really depends that a packet number, a nonce, is never reused twice. And I already mentioned that this nonce is incremented by one for every packet that is transmitted. So the second question that we need to answer is, okay, to what value is this packet number initialized? And if you look at the handshake, it's quite simple. When we install the PTK, the packet number is initialized to zero. And that makes perfect sense. I mean, you let it start at zero, always increments by one, so surely it's never reused, right? Unfortunately, we did find a way to force an implementation to reuse its packet number. So how did we manage to do that? Well, let's take the following attacker scenario. Again, we have a client that wants to connect to the access point, but now we also assume that there is an attacker nearby, and that attacker will cause a key reinstallation, and that will force nonce reuse. So how does the attack work? Well, the first thing that the attacker does is it establishes a so-called channel-based man-in-the-middle. Now, this man-in-the-middle position cannot yet be used to decrypt packets. This man-in-the-middle position is only used to reliably block packets from arriving at a particular destination. And The way we do this in a Wi-Fi network is we clone the real access point on a different channel. So let's say that your real access point is running on channel 6. Then we take all the beacon frames on all the frames that this access point is sending, and we copy and rebroadcast them on a different channel, for example, here on channel 1. And then we can force the victim, the client, into connecting to this rogue channel, in this example, to channel 1. So let's assume here that the client is indeed going to connect to the network on channel 1. Then in case this if this would be an enterprise network, and the client would first do an 802.1x authentication stage, then we would simply copy all the frames so that this authentication would complete successfully. So we copy all the frames between both these channels. Then after that, we have the four-way handshake. And again, with the first three messages of the four-way handshake, we just forward them between both channels, so it seems that the client and access point are communicating directly. However, when the client now sends message 4 of the four-way handshake, we block that from arriving at the access point, which in our man in the middle simply means not forwarding it over channel 6. Now, the interesting thing here is that from the perspective of the client, the four-way handshake has now successfully completed. It received all messages of the handshake. It also replied using all messages. So at this stage, it will install the PTK. It will install the session key to be used to encrypt data frames. However, from the access point's perspective, the handshake hasn't completed yet. And the access point will try to recover from that. So let's make a bit of space here. What the access point will do is it will retransmit message 3 of the four-way handshake. And the standard specifically says that if the client receives a retransmitted message 3, you have to reply using a new message 4. Now, interestingly, this message 4 will already be sent in an encrypted way. Now, why is that the case? That's the case because, well, we already installed a key to encrypt data frames. And these handshake messages, they're also encoded by data frames. So this handshake message is a data frame. We installed the key to encrypt data frames. So this handshake message is already encrypted. Now, we're going to abuse that later on in the attack. So what happens after the client received a retransmitted message 3 and it replied using a new message 4, then it will reinstall the session key. And again, the standard WPA2 states that this must be done. Or the problem here with reinstalling the session key is that this will cause the packet number, this will cause the nonce to reset back to 0. That means if the client now again sends a data frame, it will, before transmitting, it increases the packet number, and then it will use that value. So it was reset to 0, we increase it by 1, and this value of 1 will be used as the nonce to encrypt the data frame. But we already sent the data packets previously using the nonce value of 1, meaning we now have nonce reuse. So now the question is, how can we abuse this to, for say, decrypt a packet? Well, in order to do that, one thing we can do is first derive the key stream corresponding to this nonce value of 1. And once we know that key stream, we can decrypt this packet here shown at the bottom. And deriving the key stream corresponding to this nonce value of 1 is trivial in this example, because we have message 4 here at the top, which is sent in plain text. And a bit later, a retransmission of message 4 is sent in an encrypted fashion. Now, there is a small difference between these two frames, because the replay counter changes in those frames, but essentially they are the same. So if we XOR these two, we get the key stream, and it's the key stream corresponding to a nonce value of 1. And we can then use that key stream to decrypt the packet at the bottom, meaning we now successfully decrypted a WPA2 packet, meaning we have now broken WPA2. Is there already a question? Yes, so the question that was asked here is message 4 is being encrypted here. Now, this is something that all implementations we studied do. The WPA2 specification itself says that message 4 should just be sent in plain text, which would also be the sensible thing to do. However, every single implementation we tested sends message 4 in an encrypted fashion. So yeah, if you have questions during the talk, you can already raise your hand. So this explains the idea behind the attack against the four-way handshake. And other handshakes that are used in WPA2, they are vulnerable to a very similar attack. For example, the group key handshake, the FT handshake, and the FT handshake is used when you roam to one access point to another access point of the same network. And you also have a handshake that is used when two clients want to communicate directly with each other. Now, I'm not going to discuss each of these in details because the idea is the same. You trigger retransmissions of a handshake. This causes a key reinstallation, which resets the nonce value back to zero. So I'm going to refer to our paper if you want to know more about how to attack these handshakes. So I'm going to discuss a bit more what the practical impact of a key reinstallation is. So let's say that we have a device, and this device can be an access point, or it can be a client, and the client can, for example, be a smartphone, a laptop, or these days a client can also be a toaster, which for some reason can also already support Wi-Fi. So let's say that a client or an access point is vulnerable to a key reinstallation attack. Then, as I already mentioned, during this key reinstallation, the transmit nonce will be reset back to zero. And if the device that is vulnerable then sends encrypted data frames, we can use this to decrypt the frames that it is sending. Now, there is also a second impact of a key reinstallation attack, and that's that the receive replay counter is also reset to zero. And as the name implies, the receive replay counter is used to detect replays. And if we, as an attacker, can reset this counter, we can, of course, start replaying old data frames towards the device that is vulnerable. Now, the impact of a key reinstallation attack also heavily depends on a few other factors, and I'm going to discuss those in detail as well. So one of the important factors is what is the specific encryption protocol being used by the network. And the most popular encryption protocol is AES-CCMP, and that's used by nearly all Wi-Fi networks today. And if this algorithm is used, then it's still possible to decrypt frames. It's also possible to replay data frames. Fortunately, though, it's not possible to forge data frames. In a sense, we got lucky here, because if we would have still been using an older encryption protocol, say WPA TKIP, then in that case, we would be able to forge data frames. And the reason is that WPA TKIP uses a weak message integrity check, meaning the method it uses to assure the authenticity of frames uses a weak old algorithm. And if there is nonce reuse, we can recover the authentication key that is used by this algorithm. So I'm not going to explain the full details here. The summary is that if you have a key reinstallation attack against WPA TKIP, you can recover the authentication key, and you can then forge frames as well. Now, interestingly, there is also a third encryption algorithm that is that was recently been included in the Wi-Fi standard. It's called GCMP, and you might have heard about this under the more marketing term of WiGig. And against this new algorithm, the practical impact would, strangely enough, be the worst. Because against GCMP, if there is nonce reuse, we can again recover the authentication key. And in this case, we can use that authentication key to forge frames in both directions. Because with GCMP, once we know the authentication key, we can forge frames from the client to the access point and also from the access point to the client. And that's in strong contrast with WPA TKIP, because there, if we recover the authentication key, that can only be used in one direction. So in a sense, we got really lucky here, because if our attack would have been found, say, in 5 or 10 years, when everyone would be using GCMP, then the impact would have been a lot worse, because apart from decrypting traffic, we could also easily be injecting traffic. But luckily, we are now using still AES-CCMP mostly. So another factor that impacts the attack is which specific handshake we are attacking. So first, let's say we are attacking the group key handshake, and the group key handshake is used to transport the key that is used to protect broadcast and multicast frames. If we attack this handshake, then the impact is limited to only being able to replay broadcast frames. Now, the reason we cannot decrypt packets when we attack the group key handshake is because against the group key handshake, we can only trigger key reinstallations in the client. And interestingly, the client doesn't send real Wi-Fi broadcast frames. And let me illustrate this with the following example. Let's say we have this network set up, and we have the client here on the left that wants to send a broadcast IP packet, for example. Now, the way this works in a Wi-Fi network is that this broadcast IP packet will first be sent as a unicast Wi-Fi packet to the access point. And then the access point will broadcast it as a real broadcast Wi-Fi frame to all associated clients. And this assures that, you know, every device within range of the access point will receive this broadcast message. But for us, this means that only the access point sends true encrypted broadcast Wi-Fi frames, and the client doesn't send actual broadcast frames. So that means that if we trigger a key reinstallation in the client, well, the client isn't sending broadcast data frames, meaning it won't reuse these encryptions. It won't reuse these nonsense when encrypting broadcast frames. So the only thing that happens is that the client will reset its replay counter, meaning we can replay broadcast frames to the client. So the other handshake that we can attack is the four-way handshake, and already discussed that in detail. What we can do against the four-way handshake is we can decrypt and replay frames, and depending on the specific encryption protocol, specific cipher that we use, it might also be possible to forge data frames. Finally, we also have the FT handshake. And the FT handshake is used to quickly roam from one access point to another access point of the same network. So that, for example, if you are using Skype, then you can quickly hand off to the next access point without your connection being interrupted. Again, the impact is the same. We can replay, decrypt, and possibly forge frames. But the one thing that makes the attack much worse against the FT handshake is that we do not require a man in the middle position to attack it. And on top of this, we attack the access point and not the client. So why is this the case? Well, if we look at the FT handshake, we can see that the FT handshake is initiated by the client. On the other hand, the four-way handshake, there the first message was sent by the access point. And basically, the FT handshake is very similar to the four-way handshake. So the first two messages are used to transport these random numbers between both devices. And then the second stage is used to confirm that both parties negotiated the same encryption key. And if both of them indeed negotiated the same encryption key, it is installed for usage to actually encrypt data frames. And once the PTK has installed, as you can see at the bottom, encrypted data frames can indeed be exchanged between both devices. So what happens here is that, similar to the four-way handshake, we can take message three of this handshake, which in this case is the reassociation request, and we can again replay this handshake message. So let's make some space here. So we're going to replay the reassociation request, and this frame is sent towards the access point. So as illustrated here, we can simply take the reassociation request that was previously sent and just replay it without any modification at all. And that's because this message does not contain a replay counter, meaning the access point will not realize that, oh, this is a replayed handshake message. So when the access point receives this replayed handshake message, it will accept it. It will reply using a new message 4 of the handshake. And here, message 4 is a reassociation response. And after sending that response, it will reinstall the session key similar to the four-way handshake, except it's now the access point that is reinstalling the key instead of the client. And yeah, here it's exactly the same as before. The nonce is then reset to zero, meaning if we now encrypt the next data frame, it will reuse the nonce value of one, which in turn we can use to decrypt frames. So another factor that impacts the effect of the attack is which specific implementation we are attacking. For example, if we look at iOS 10 or Windows, then we see that the four-way handshake is not vulnerable. And the reason that it's not vulnerable is that these implementations deviate a little bit from the standard, and they don't accept retransmissions of message 3 of the handshake. So in a sense, it's a bit funny. I mean, they deviate from the handshake, and because of that, they are more secure. And yeah, because they are not affected, it means that we cannot attack the four-way handshake to then decrypt traffic that is sent between them. However, one important remark here is that iOS 11 does properly implement the standard. It does accept retransmissions of message 3, meaning it now is vulnerable. Now, there's one thing I want to mention here is that, and that's that these implementations deviate from the standard, but I can actually understand that they deviate from the standard because the standard is a little bit vague whether message 3 has to be accepted if it's a retransmission. It's only if you very carefully read the standard that it's clear that retransmissions of message 3 should be accepted. Now, there's another very interesting implementation, and that's the Wi-Fi client that is used on Linux on Android devices, namely WPA Supplicant. And what we found here is that if you attack WPA Supplicant 2.4 or higher, then instead of reinstalling this secret key that is being negotiated, it will reinstall an all-zero encryption key. And of course, if you use an all-zero encryption key, the attacker knows which key you are using, meaning it becomes trivial to decrypt any data that the client is sending. So you may be wondering now, how on earth did this happen? Why is it suddenly installing an all-zero encryption key? Well, there's actually a quite understandable reason why this happens. So let me explain that. So again, let's say we have a client here on the left, in this case an Android device, that wants to connect to an access point. Now we're going to zoom a bit in on the implementation of our Android of our Linux device. In particular, we're going to look at two entities here. We're going to look at WPA Supplicant, which implements the four-way handshake itself, and then we also have the Linux kernel. So these are two separate entities, and the idea is here that WPA Supplicant implements the four-way handshake, and once the four-way handshake is completed, WPA Supplicant will command the Linux kernel into using this encryption key to start decrypting frames. And of course, we still here have our attacker, which will trigger these key reinstallations. So what will happen here is that, yeah, we have our first stage of the four-way handshake. The client will derive the session key. Then we have message 3 and message 4 that are being sent. Again, the adversary here on the right blocks message 4 from arriving at the access point, meaning later on the access point will retransmit message 3. However, first, after the client received the first message 3 and replied using message 4, it will install the encryption key. And the way that this happens is that, as I mentioned, WPA Supplicant will command the Linux kernel into installing the encryption key that was negotiated. And the Linux kernel, so the driver that implements really the encryption algorithm that will encrypt the data frames, it will keep this encryption key in memory in the kernel itself, which means that WPA Supplicant, which is just a userland program, no longer needs to store the session key, meaning it clears the PTK from memory. It clears the session key from memory. So the interesting thing that happens now is, again, the access point didn't receive message 4 yet, so it will retransmit message 3. Again, the client will accept message 3. It will reply using a message 4. And at this point, it will command the Linux kernel into reinstalling the key. Now, the way that this happens is that WPA supplicant will say to the Linux kernel, hey, please install the session key that is located at this position in the memory. But that position in the memory has been reset to all zeros. So basically, WPA supplicant is commanding the Linux kernel into installing an all zero encryption key. And of course, at this point, you can do whatever you want with the client. You can decrypt all the data it's sending, and you can send data towards it as well. So I hope you realize that, you know, this is a mistake even I could have made if the implementation is complex. Now, after hearing all this, you may be a bit worried, like, is my device vulnerable as well? And in order to test that, we made a few scripts available online. They can be found at the following URL. And these allow you to test whether a client or access point is vulnerable to some of the attacks that we discussed here. And if you use these scripts, I recommend to just use a very default Kali Linux distribution. That's also the one where we tested these scripts on. Additionally, we noticed that these scripts are sometimes unreliable with specific Wi-Fi dongles. And in order to make these scripts more reliable, I recommend using a dongle, a Wi-Fi dongle that we tested as well. And you should also disable hardware encryption. How to do that is also explained on this repository. Now, if you do this, you will realize that some devices will still be vulnerable. I'm especially thinking about old smartphones. And yeah, that's the sad reality we have to live with. Many clients won't get updates. Fortunately, though, by modifying the access point, we can prevent a lot of attacks against the client. In particular, we can modify the access point so that it never retransmits message 3 of the four-way handshake, and that it never transmits also the first message of the group key handshake. And if the access point is modified in this way, then if a client is connected to such a modified access point, then it cannot be attacked. Now, there might be a few downsides. The downside is, yeah, that because we are not sending these retransmissions, if you are in a network with a lot of noise, with an unreliable network, it could be that sometimes the handshake will fail while otherwise it would have succeeded. And of course, if you have a vulnerable client and you connect with an access point that doesn't contain these modifications, then of course the client can still be attacked. So now I'm going to cover a few misconceptions about the attack that have been floating around on the internet. And the first big misconception is that some claim that if you only update the client or if you only update the access point, then you're fine. But that's not the case. Because if you only update your client and you then connect to an access point that's vulnerable, then we can still attack the access point. And the reverse is also true. If you update the access point, meaning if you only update the access point so that the FT handshake is no longer vulnerable, then it's still possible to attack clients. And that's because the additional countermeasure I mentioned previously, where we can modify the access point to prevent attacks against the client, that's really an extra modification. Because we have the default patch of access points, which prevents the access point itself being attacked, and then this extra modification to prevent attacks against the client, not everyone will include this patch. So the summary is that if you update your access point, you have to assume that it's still possible to attack clients only if the update of your access point explicitly mentions that it prevents attacks against clients, do you only need to update the access point. So another misconception that I hear quite frequently is that people say that, yeah, it's a very interesting and cool attack, but you know, as an attacker, you need to be very close to the network in order to pull this off. However, in practice, that's not the case, because researchers have shown that using very cheap custom antenna, you can basically mess with a network from quite far away. In particular, these researchers were able to do this from a distance from, I think it was around 2 miles. And recently, I've also encountered a few leaked NSA documents from Snowden, and there was one slide which mentioned that The NSA is sometimes able to attack a Wi-Fi network from up to 8 miles away. And that's a huge distance. Now, obviously, that's going to be 8 miles away with a clear line of sight without any obstacles. But still, you know, it's a long distance. So we have to assume that, you know, if you have a motivated attacker, he can be far away. Another misconception is that I sometimes hear that in order to pull off the attack, some people claim that the adversary or the attacker already needs to be connected to the network itself. In other words, that the attacker needs to have the password of the network. But you know, that's not the case at all, because in the attacks that I just explained recently, we never assumed that the attacker knows the password of the network. We can simply establish this channel-based man-in-the-middle position that does not require the password of the network. Then we can trigger these retransmissions of message 3, and then we can cause the key reinstallations on attack WPA2. Another remark I often hear, and this one is a quite understandable remark, is that, again, the tech is quite cool, but after the handshake, the implementation you are attacking isn't really sending any interesting data that you want to decrypt. Because after you just executed the four-way handshake, you know, the kind of data that is transmitted is, for example, ARP requests, can be DHCP packets, or it can be TCP SYN packets to open TCP connections. In other words, there isn't really any interesting data to decrypt. So the impact of the attack is low, right? But unfortunately, that's not the case. What an attacker can do is it can let a client, it can let a victim reconnect to a network normally. The victim will then open connections to websites or to email providers and so on. And once the victim has some connection open where we want to decrypt data in, then what we can do is forcibly disconnect the client from the Wi-Fi network, and every operating system will then immediately try to reconnect to the Wi-Fi network by doing a new four-way handshake. And while this new four-way handshake is executed, the client will buffer any outgoing data packets. Meaning, after the four-way handshake is completed, it will send these buffer data packets, which we as an attacker can then decrypt. So to summarize, what we can do is we can wait until the victim will send interesting data. We then disconnect the client so that when the four-way handshake completes, it will send us interesting data, which we can then decrypt. Another remark is that some people say obtaining this channel-based man-in-the-middle, that it's hard, because as an attacker, you need to have, for example, a higher transmit power than the real access point. But again, that's not the case, because obtaining this special man-in-the-middle position does not rely on your transmit power. And the reason that's the case is that we can use a special frame called a channel switch announcement. We can send that to, for example, an Android device or a Windows device, and this frame instructs the client into switching to a different channel. So obtaining this man-in-the-middle position is not based on the transmit power of your Wi-Fi antenna. We can simply command the victim into switching to the channel that we want. So this is very easy to do in practice. Another remark is that people will say that the attack complexity is hard, meaning that it will be difficult for adversaries to carry out this attack. And I can agree that implementing the attack is not trivial. It requires some expertise. But of course, once the script is written and it's made public, then people can just take the script and execute it themselves. So really, we should be assuming that people will indeed be able to carry out this attack in practice. So now for the final slide of misconception. Another one that I sometimes hear is that if you use AES CCMP, that this encryption algorithm mitigates the attack, but that's not the case. Although if you use AES CCMP, it's not possible to forge data frames, meaning the impact is lower. Against AES CCMP, it's still possible to decrypt frames and to replay frames as well. So even if you use AES CCMP, we can still attack your network. Additionally, if you use an enterprise network with 802.1x authentication, restrictions, say if you have to log in using a username or a password, or if you have to log in using certificates that some people will claim that that's not vulnerable. But this network setup is also vulnerable because it still uses the four-way handshake after the 802.1x authentication phase, meaning we can still carry out all the attacks that we discussed previously. Now, then there are also some people that will say that this attack is the end of the world. Everything is completely broken now. But, you know, let's not get carried away. It's not the end of the world. In particular, we can patch our devices in a backwards compatible way. So we'll be fine. So finally, I want to discuss some lessons that we can learn from this research. And the first lesson, which to me is really the most interesting one, is that the four-way handshake was formally, so mathematically, proven to be secure. And the encryption protocol afterwards, in particular AES-CCMP, was also proven to be secure. However, what went wrong is that if you combined these two components, that combination was not proven secure. And that's also exactly what we abused in our attack. Because the proof of the four-way handshake, that proof stated that the negotiated key remains secret. And indeed, we as an attacker, we cannot recover the session key that is used by the network. We cannot recover the password of the network. And the encryption protocol here, the most important thing about the proof of that encryption protocol is that that proof assumes that the encryption key is only installed once. But of course, we can trick the four-way handshake into installing this encryption key multiple times, and in the sense that breaks the assumptions that the proof of the encryption protocol relies on. The proof of the AES-CCMP requires that a key is only installed once, but we can manipulate the four-way handshake into installing these keys multiple times, and that's exactly where it goes wrong. So to summarize, formally verifying implementations on proving protocols in this way is a very good thing. We should keep doing that. However, we should also, in a sense, audit these proofs, and we should not just prove the individual components, but we, at least as academics, also need to prove the combination of all these subcomponents. Now, another interesting lesson, which is more for implementers, is that we should avoid complex implementations. For example, if we look at WPA Supplicant 2.6, then initially we thought it wasn't vulnerable to key reinstallation attacks. And the reason we thought that is because if you carry out the attack, as I mentioned during this presentation, where you just trigger a retransmission of message 3 and send that to the client, then WPA Supplicant 2.6 will not reinstall the key. However, there is a way by forging an additional message between before forwarding the retransmitted message 3, so we can trigger key reinstallations. So to keep it simple, basically WPA Supplicant, its implementation contains a complex state machine, and it's very hard to reason about. And well, there are two lessons that we can learn from this. The first is you should avoid complex implementations, and the second lesson is that it's also a good idea to not only prove the security of the encryption protocol at an abstract level, it's also a good idea to formally verify the security of implementations itself. Now, of course, it's going to be way too much work to formally verify everything that you program. That's just not possible time-wise. However, we can focus on the essential components of applications, for example, the cryptographic components, and do formally verify that code. And now, this lesson that we have to keep our implementation simple, it's not really a new lesson. I mean, we already know this. And interestingly, if you look at other leaked documents in this case, the CIA, then the CIA has a document which describes best practices when they are implementing some malware, and this malware wants to communicate back home. And interestingly, the CIA is saying that if you have a malware and you are running it on a victim and you are sending data back to us, you of course should use some encryption protocol. However, in that protocol, we recommend to disable rekeying and we recommend disabling all these extra features. And the reason they recommend that is because all these extra features introduce unnecessary complexity. And again, this unnecessary complexity might lead to bugs. So this is again an argument that shows that you should keep your implementation simple, because the more complex they are, the more likely that there's a vulnerability in them. So the last thing I want to discuss is the disclosure process that we followed when we discovered this vulnerability, because this is not your ordinary disclosure process. It's not just one company that's affected by it and we only need to communicate with this one company. No, in this case, we have a flawed standard, which means it could be that every implementation of WPA2 is affected. So how on earth are you going to coordinate that kind of disclosure? Well, the first thing that we did is we really wanted to be sure that this was indeed a flaw in the standard. And we weren't just lucky that the few implementations we tested ourselves were vulnerable, and that, who knows, all the other implementations were in fact fine. So the steps we took is that we first contact a selected few vendors, and we basically told them, hey, we possibly found a flaw in the WPA standard. We don't know if your devices are affected because we don't have them. However, we would really appreciate if you would check if your devices are affected. And we quickly got responses that indeed these devices that we didn't test ourselves were also vulnerable. And that was confirmed that, this really is an issue in the standard itself and not just in the few implementations that we tested. And once we knew this, we had to determine, okay, who are we all going to inform? Because if we would inform every single vendor of some Wi-Fi protocol, then the problem with that is that so many people will know about the vulnerability that the chance that the details get leaked are very high. So we need to somehow make a decision here between notifying enough companies, but on the other hand, if we notify really everyone, the chance of leaking it is very high, and that loses the advantage of our vulnerability discoordination. So what we did is, in this case, is we simply contacted a cert from US, and we let them decide who to contact, because they know all the companies better than we academics do. So then another question that we have to handle is, okay, but how long will you keep this vulnerability under embargo? Again, this is sometimes a topic where there are a lot of discussions and a lot of opinions. But again, here, you have to make a trade-off. Because if this embargo is very long, then okay, the companies get a long time to patch this. But of course, the longer you try to keep it secret, the higher there's a chance that someone will leak this. On the other hand, if this embargo is very short, then people don't have enough time to patch. So this is a difficult decision. The one piece of advice I can give here is, just pick a deadline and stick to it, so at least the situation is clear and everyone knows what to expect. Another interesting problem here is, how do you handle open source patches? Because generally, development is done using public mailing lists, and the source code is also public. And the way we handled this is that we were privately in contact with the maintainers of open source projects. We tested the patch in private. And 1 week before the disclosure deadline, the patches that we developed were distributed over a private mailing list. And this worked quite well for us. So the advice I would give here is develop the open source patches in private. A week or more or less before the disclosure, distribute them to all the distributions, so all the Linux distributions, for example, so that they can prepare their packages. And this has worked well for us, at least. And this problem of having to deal with multiple parties during this vulnerability coordination In a sense, it's not really a new problem. People have faced it before. And there's also an interesting document that describes best practices on how to handle this. So let's say that you are in a similar scenario where you found a vulnerability, a lot of parties are affected, and you want some advice on how to best coordinate this, I would recommend reading this document. And personally, I would keep in mind that the end goal of all of this is to protect the users. It's not to protect the reputation of companies. In the end, we want users to be more secure. And of course, there are various opinions about how to do this and how not to do this. So, to conclude the talk, the flaw that we found is in the WPA2 standard itself. The most interesting aspect that I found about this attack is that, you know, this protocol was proven to be secure, but we managed to break it anyway. And on top of that, it's not just a theoretic crypto attack where you need to do a lot of fancy maths or you need to do computations for more than a year. No, we can actually execute these attacks in practice. And my final piece of advice is you should update all your clients, your smartphone, your laptop, and also check if your access points are vulnerable, and if so, update them as well. So with that, I conclude my presentations. Thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, you can ask them.
I'll repeat the question. Okay, so do you actually have a CVE for this? Is my question.
So there are quite a few CVEs allocated for this vulnerability. So if you visit crackattacks.com, so the link is shown here, you can get an overview of all the CVEs. And with the script I mentioned on GitHub, there's also a link to that script on the website. You can test for most CVEs. Okay, so the question was, is if Open WRT is already updated? I haven't looked at that myself. I would say that, you know, they generally use the open source WPA supplicant or host APD. So normally they should be patched. Yes, they should be. So the question was if there are any working practical exploits. So we released our own very basic proof of concept to trigger key reinstallations against Linux devices. We weren't very public about this, so we released our own attack script. I have heard of some people that are trying to redo our work and also try to implement their own attack script. But I haven't heard of a lot of people that are really using this in practice. So the current situation now is that our own script is public. It works in a lab setup. In practice, it can be still a bit tedious to execute it. So the situation now is there are public scripts to do this. They work in a lab setup. In practice, they might still have some issues, but those can be addressed by updating the script.
How do you acquire that MITM position? You told that to acquire MITM position, you have to send the packet to client to change its channel.
I didn't catch the question.
My question is how you acquire the MITM position, because you need
how
to,
I acquire what?
How the MITM can stop the packets from the packets which are going from client to access point. The MITM need to stop those packets. So how it is doing that?
The man in the middle. Okay, so how we obtain this man in the middle question. Okay, so the way we obtain this man in the middle question is, say the access point is operating on channel 6, and then we clone it on channel 1. So the idea is that we force a victim into thinking that the real access point is on channel 1, then the client will send messages on channel 1, and the real access point will not receive these messages because it's operating on a different channel. So what we do as an attacker is we capture these frames that are sent on channel one by the client. We take those frames, and then we rebroadcast them on a second Wi-Fi antenna on channel six. And then the access point will receive these frames. And in turn, the access point will reply to these frames on channel six. We again, the client will not capture these frames because it's on channel one. So we capture these frames on channel six on our first Wi-Fi antenna. Then we rebroadcast them on our second Wi-Fi antenna, which is on channel one. So the client one will receive it. So every frame that is sent between the client and attacker has to pass through us. I hope that explains it. And otherwise, we can discuss it offline. Thank you.